Hey guys, today we're going to talk about my top 5 favorite electronic upgrades for the 350Z. My first modification that I pick would be upgrading the grounds. Now, this is a touchy subject for some people because a lot of people believe that the factory grounds are good enough and they're thick enough, you don't need to upgrade them. Well, if you're adding things like the sound system or you're upgrading other electronics additional on top, besides upgrading your alternator, upgrading the grounds is a very economical way and it's good preventive maintenance to make sure all the electronics work properly. I did a previous big three upgrade video and I mentioned that it helps the sensors on the motor work better because it's a point of reference to ground. Now, a lot of people had a problem with that theory because they're saying it gets its reference from a reference to ground from the PCM or the ECU, which is correct. However, the car's computer, how do you think it gets its ground? Because a lot of the times, I'm pretty sure the factory ECUs don't run their wire from the computer all the way directly to the battery. They're typically just grounded in the kick or something like that. Also, a lot of people like this, since the sensors get their ground reference from the computer or the ECU, that upgrading the grounds are not necessary on the motor at all. That's a bunch of hooey. Now, I'm going to challenge that because here is a factory ground. And here's a factory ground. Now, those grounds could be for several things. It could be to work other devices like the variable valve timing, or it could be sensors. I cannot verify that unless I had a factory schematic and the engineer that helped design the car tell me specifically what those grounds are. But what I can tell you is, since there's a ground here and a ground here, it's obviously for something. So if we do put thicker wire on that is newer and has the ability to flow a lot of amperage, it can't hurt, and it's probably gonna help things at least. The factory grounds on the battery is actually in the middle here, and there's probably, it looks like there is, well, I added a bunch of stuff here. It looks like it's just one big 4-gauge wire. So we only have one fat 4-gauge wire, and 4-gauge to some people isn't even that big, but for the most part, 4-gauge is a good size. So we have one 4-gauge wire. On the motor I showed you, there was a 10-gauge wire, and there were, it looked like either 14-gauge or 16-gauge wires on that area alone. So where do those wires go to? They usually probably just bolt on somewhere else under in the engine bay. Well, there's a bunch of other grounds in these cars that are bolted to the kick. So since these things are on the kick or in the engine bay and they're not directly connected to each other by a wire, that means that if the ground is poor or the metal in between is poor, we might have a bad ground. That's why we upgrade these things, because we just start to make connections like on the firewall, and the engine bay and into the kick to help make sure that everything is connected well together. Now, I went actually overboard on mine, and I'll put the video in the cards where I actually run the ground from the negative terminal inside and I bolt to the kick and I actually make junction points. So it's technically wire on wire, but I'm using factory threads and I did a perimeter around the whole car. So my hopes is the theory is to have as least resistance as possible for all the devices. Now, it's not gonna be perfect, but it's definitely gonna be better than whatever the factory provided. My next biggest upgrade would be the security system and or a remote starter. Now, you don't have to have a remote starter, but I think it's cool and it can be convenient. You know, in the summertime, I like to turn on the AC before I get to the car, let it cool down. I don't drive the car in the winter, so that's all I use the remote starter for, or it's just the cool factor. The other thing too is you wanna protect your vehicle. Now, a lot of people say like, well, they just beep, they don't do anything. Well, if you have cell phone control, or smartphone integration like I do, we can arm the vehicle, or I can even, let's say, roll the windows up. There is a little bit of a delay. Not too bad. See, windows are going up. There's my verification on the phone. And then my two-way remote also verifies if I'm within range. And the cool thing too is we can do things like GPS tracking. That's the biggest thing for protection. So if someone does try to take your vehicle, they tow it. That's what most people do. If I were to steal a vehicle, if I'm a thief, I'm gonna tow the vehicle. I'm not gonna even try to break in. Not with the factory immobilizers and aftermarket immobilizers. I'm just gonna tow the thing. So if it goes missing, you can set up your phone to alert you and just call the cops and tell them, hey, can you go pick up my car? It's over here. Yes, there are people that have shown videos, and it's built in for factory where you hit the factory lock, I think it's the factory unlock button, you roll the windows down, or you put your key in the tumbler and roll them down, but you're already at the vehicle, so I don't see the big point of that. So we can do that too with the aftermarket one. But let's say you're not going to drive away in the vehicle and you need to roll your windows back up. So you're going to walk all the way to your vehicle, put the key in, turn it and raise the windows, or turn on the ignition and raise the windows, or you get the aftermarket system, which will allow you to roll them back up. Obviously, you can also do trunk release as well. I don't see it being a huge deal to do on the 350. It's kind of, I really actually don't know why. It's like, it's only if the button's broken, because if you think about it, if you unlock the vehicle, you can always just hit the button underneath, because you have to come up here and lift it. But I'm obviously going to hook it up anyways. But trunk release, kind of, if you think about how it works with the button in the back, if you're unlocking the vehicle, it's like, do you really need it? It's just there for the sake of being there, I guess. This one's actually my favorite one, because it's like one of those things like no one ever has. So the vehicle's left-hand drive, and the gas lid's the same if you're right-hand drive or left-hand drive. So if you're in a right-hand drive environment, if you forget to open up the gas lid and you're at the gas station, not a big deal. You just open the door, you're right there. However, for those of us like in North America where we're on the left side, you gotta walk all the way around the vehicle. And you know, North Americans are lazy. So all I have to do, if I forget, music is another big one for me, and I think it's hard to find anyone that doesn't like music. I'm sure someone's cousin's boyfriend's sister knows someone that doesn't like music, but for the most part, I'm going to say in your immediate group of friends or circle of people you know, people like music. So I'm going to say upgrading the sound system is one of my top things to do as well. Now, it doesn't have to be anything huge, and it doesn't have to be anything super loud. Like in my vehicle, I have 112, it's a thin JLW TW12, and it's a W3, and it doesn't take up that much space, but because the vehicle is a hatchback, I don't need a huge subwoofer to deliver a lot of bass in the vehicle to get good sound out of it. I've also upgraded the speakers all around with Hertz High Energies. Now, you can pick whatever speakers you want. I just picked the Hertz because they're really, they're very clear and they have a lot of mid-range bass. But the factory speakers were pretty subpar, even on the Bose system. So I didn't have the Bose system, but I've heard them. They do not compare to this. So I have a component setup up front, and I actually only ran the mid-range in the rear. I do not have a tweeter in the rear because I wanted the imaging to come all from the front when it comes to my highs. To power up your system, space intrusion can be minimal as well. You can see here, I have an Alpine PDX 5-channel amplifier, and it gives me 100 watts per channel for the speakers, and it gives me 500 watts RMS for the subwoofer. And obviously we're going to change out the head unit to have all the latest and greatest connectivity. I value having a radar detector as long as it's legal to have in your area. I do not have jammers or shifters on this vehicle, I just have a detector. And it helps me keep the vehicle in check, let's say. So it does not make you invincible. Some people think like, oh, I drove by a cop and didn't go off. Well, it'll only work if the cop's vehicle is equipped with radar equipment and if it's actually turned on. So I find this most useful on the highway, especially on the number one where there are a lot of speed traps. So yeah, it keeps me in check when I'm driving the car. Now on this particular car, I have a built-in one. I prefer built-in because it's a lot more stealth. So if I don't want to look at it, I can just close my sunglass holder. I still have my LED indicator here. So if it's red, and depending on as you drive it, you'll learn it makes different sounds for different bands. So K band has a different audio warning than KA band. So I can tell because I've owned it for a while, but at least if it's going red, you know there's something. But it's not just for cops only. So the cool thing about this is, depending on the area that you live in, it can also give you safety warnings as well for construction zones and things like that. But that all depends on your area and what they're using for their technologies. Doing some sort of lighting upgrade on the 350 is icing on the cake, and for one, there's two reasons. One, it looks a lot better, and two, it's a lot less maintenance. Those of you that own the 350 and have changed out the lights in the headlights, whether it be the turn signal or the headlights, switching up to an LED version is going to last a lot longer. Especially those of you that have lower cars with a very harsh suspension, you might be changing out those bulbs a lot more than you want to. We can also update our lighting for safety as well, like we have these switchbacks on the front bumper. some 350s already have LED lighting in the taillight. However, down the bumper, the way that the casing looks on the lens looks kind of lame, and it doesn't look very modern. So by updating the rear bumper lights, you can get more safety by adding more lights and having more distinct signals, and also clean up the looks and make it look like a more modern vehicle. Well guys, those are my top 5 electrical upgrades, and we covered safety, convenience, and driving enjoyment with all those mods. Now what are your top 5 mods? Do you guys already have some of the stuff in your car? Would you add on top after seeing this video, or would you not do it? Comment below and let me know. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button, and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way, at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus, with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section, and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.